first ever techno conference, and I hope you take advantage of all the opportunities offered here and learn all you can about technology and how charities can best use it. There's been so much guidance, so many ideas, so much advice and tips for our presenters, for our AFP peeps, and from each other, sharing ideas and experiences. I've had a great time, and I hope you have too. I want to remind you, it doesn't have to end here. In fact, this is the beginning. We're going to have a lot of understanding of technology to do, because it changes every day, and we need to keep our conversation going. Techno doesn't just have to be a two-day event, but the beginning of conversations and lessons and experiences that go on and on. We have a number of Twitter hashtags, and you can continue to use our Techno Facebook page as well. I hope you will keep in touch with each other. I hope we will continue the discussions, because as we all know, there is still a lot left to learn. We have an extraordinary speaker here today. We are fortunate to have Steve Wozniak with us. Please. Second, let us never forget that all of this is changing about operations, but not our purpose, not our principles. Technology can help us make the connection, but it cannot be the connection. The relationship is the connection. Well, I hope you've enjoyed our first ever Techno Conference. It's been great having all of you here, and we're honored if you would join us. It is now my great pleasure to introduce the chair of AFP, Andrew McManus. The following year, he introduced his Apple II personal computer, which was integral in launching the personal computer industry. For his achievements at Apple Computer, Mr. Wozniak was awarded the National Medal of Technology by the President of the United States in 1985, the highest honor bestowed on America's leading innovators. In 2000, he was inducted into the Inventors Hall of Fame and was awarded the prestigious Heinz Award for Technology, the Economy, and Employment for single-handedly designing the first personal computer and for then redirecting his lifelong passion for mathematics and electronics toward lighting the fires of excitement for education in grade school students and their teachers. Through the years, Mr. Wozniak has been involved in various business and philanthropic ventures. He adopted the Los Gatos School District, providing students and teachers with hands-on teaching and donations of state-of-the-art technology equipment. He also founded the Electronic Frontier Foundation and was the founding sponsor of the Tech Museum, Silicon Valley Ballet, and Children's Discovery Museum of San Jose. He currently serves as chief scientist for Fusion.io and is a published author with the release of his New York Times best-selling autobiography, I Was, From Computer Greek to Cult Icon, in September of 2006. An entrepreneur, a philanthropist, a visionary, a guru, all of those and more. And ladies and gentlemen, please join me in welcoming the Woz, the one and only.
I do a lot of work with FIRST Robotics, which is high school teams of kids that build human-sized robots that play games every year, and we have dozens of competitions throughout the world and swung down to a final. I care so much about the young technologists being appreciated, like the superstars, the athletes of the schools are, and having their day in the sun. But it's very important to us that they have to be sponsored. These things cost money, and companies have to really donate stuff. The organization itself is very good at getting very large corporations to donate a lot, and places like NASA that believe in doing these good causes. But it's like individual companies will sponsor a high school. And they also have the part of the responsibility is send a mentor. Coaches that have been there before know how it's done. When we started Apple, Steve Jobs and I were young. We were in our 20s. We had no money in savings accounts. We had no relatives or friends that could loan us money. And we ran into an angel that would invest in our idea, and I'll talk about that later. But he really coached us, taught us what our roles and responsibilities were, what kinds of people we have to hire for a company, what their roles would be. And he's really the person who made Apple, although you never hear about it. And he had as much stock as Steve Jobs and myself. But the importance of a coach, of a mentor, is so important. You sometimes want to carry that on in life. I go around the world and I talk a lot to technology groups. What I'm going to talk about today is a lot of personal stories of my own philanthropy, mostly, and some raising money. And it's going to be, and it's like I've never spoken about this before. So everything you're hearing is kind of like unknown, fresh new stuff for the most part. As far as fundraising goes, I'm not really a fundraiser. I was a technologist, not a businessman, not a politician in any way. You know, you could teach me the fundamentals of fundraising, how you go about it, how you touch different people. I'm very shy. I was too scared to, even to this day, to go socialize with new people and strangers. I don't know how to speak their language. I don't know how to do the common little social things you have to do to become, you know, close to somebody that you're going to try to buy into your dreams and you know, what your organization's all about. Obviously, the modern computers that I've been associated with are essential to organizing and collecting and collaborating and keeping track of everything that's going on in the organizations that you're raising funds for. You know, the accountants are sometimes the most important people, especially in the early days of a new, like, nonprofit startup. Being a nerd, it's kind of like I was always an outsider. And being an outsider forced me to want to think differently. And think and not care what other people said was the ways things are done. You become a very independent thinker when you're kind of all alone in your room and you just have a lot of thoughts to yourself. You can reflect on ideas, you can work them out, you can make them excellent, you can be diligent, you can have extreme focus that way. And that would apply even to things like fundraising. Don't be afraid to take some free time and just dream and come up with, you know, new ideas. And even though people say that's not how it's done, doesn't mean that it will not work. I've got a lot of experience along those lines. Most of my experience with fundraising has been from, not from your side, but from the other end. But, you know, fundraising is almost always for institutions that represent goodness. To me, when I was young, I formulated a lot of ideas about good, bad, right, wrong in the world, and I stuck to them very much. I was never going to be corrupted by money and wealth and get dragged off into other things of the world. I was going to remain the young Steve Wozniak that had these good ideals. And the apex of all good to me is truth. Always be truthful about what you're doing. Even if there's some negatives sounding to your story, people respect you a lot more, especially people with money that might want to buy in, respect you a lot more if they know that you're telling them the truth and that's first and foremost. A baby born into this world, is it born with a pure, good, giving soul? No, I think babies just want to get what they can get for a while. You know, but they start to realize that somebody is giving them what they need in life. I think inside, early core values, even before you can express them or think or know them necessarily, are that the people that help me are very important in my life. So we grow up, and when we're infants and we're children, we learn by examples of others. We hear stories that are put to us, our family pressures and schools and the cartoons we watch, the stories about, you know, the guy who goes and runs a race to win money to give to an orphanage and save the world. When I was young, the books that inspired me towards technology were all about young inventor Tom Swift Jr., and he owned a company with his father, and he'd go into the laboratory, and he would design things to build equipment that would solve the problems of the world. that would free the people, that would entrap an alien presence to talk to it and learn more. But it was always for some good. And you know what? To be the hero of the world, to be that good, I wanted to be an engineer very much. Some of us, you know, somehow arrive at the end of things. You know, by the time our personality is set around age 20, some of us are more giving types than others. And I wound up very much on the giving side and the caring. I think that a lot of people that give are ones that care. It's like when you feel something in your heart and it brings emotion to you, that's very important. It's like I go to movies all the time, you know, and I'll just be in tears. I watched The Big Miracle, saving three whales in Alaska on the airplane flight in here, and I just cried all the way through that movie. And I do. It's like if somebody needs help, and humans are going to help them, I'm not just cry talking about it. It's so deep within me, and this always, and it always has been. You know, and those who don't have enough in life, I care so much about them. You know, I was lucky. I was never going to have to worry about my life. I was so advanced in electronics. I was never going to go to college even and think, what do I do when I get out of college? Out of high school, I could easily get a job in electronics. I was designing computers right and left, you know, and I could design the computer, made it a couple of days. So the skills, I had extreme skills in one area. And I was very lucky for that. I never had to worry about what I was going to do. I wanted to be a computer person. I wanted to be an engineer in my life. I wonder how many people, when they're young, decide, I want to be a fundraiser for charities. It's not impossible to imagine it could happen. Get these ideas in your head. Maybe there should be a series of books where the hero is a fundraiser. Now, as a caring person, I care about not only people, but also animals. I care about my dogs. I will eat hamburgers, but I am going to stop and get a filet steak to bring home to my dog. And then the barbecue chicken and all this really good stuff. And I just say to my wife, I say, would you eat their dog food? And she says, no. So she goes along with me. you know, this. I look at it like I have this inner desire to help others and to the extent that I'm able to, and I've always felt that way, but I don't ever want to be judgmental. It's one thing to grow up learning, you know, you don't want to say this value should be applied to everyone in life. This is good, and other people that don't give are bad. Those poor are bad. Those that are greedy are bad. I don't like to say that. I just will not go out and make it a big deal like you should be like me. It's basically you make the decisions for yourself and you be the kind of person you want to be, and there should be no pressure to really deviate from who you really are. You know, I assume all the time that, you know, if I give well, it serves as an example to others. Others will see it and they'll say, whoa, look at that. And then you look at the results and look at the good that's being done. I would like to be in that place when you hear about these stories. Just like books you've read, movies you've seen, you know, the TV shows you've watched in your life, you can serve as an inspiration to others to see that, okay, especially if you are a good person and well accepted in society, your examples will have more meaning to others. I find that everywhere I go, a lot of young people, they read my books or they hear about things I've done, and they tell me that they want to be like that too. And if they ever, you know, make more money and get wealthy, they really want to go out and give it and be charitable. And I'm going to talk about a lot of ways to do that. I also believe that technology is good. You know, I grew up being taught by my father that we as engineers would create new things that didn't exist, like washing machines. And I imagine my great-grandparents watching close by hand. I thought, oh my God, they had a hard, rough life. And they didn't ever sleep, and they just worked all day. And I grew up thinking, we're making a better life as an engineer. So my reason for being an engineer was very much a giving reason. I wanted to give people, you know, a better life. And maybe someday, we wouldn't have to work as hard. We'd only have to work 4 days a week instead of 5 days a week. So,
yeah.
It's funny though, what happened was we were totally successful in my lifetime. of creating the new machinery makes life so much more powerful. It makes people 100 times more productive than ever before. Everything you do with a computer, you just couldn't hardly imagine doing with pencil and paper anymore, most things. And we were totally successful in creating new wealth for society. But for some reason, we didn't get 4 days a week working. Now it takes two people working full-time stressfully just to own a home in Silicon Valley. So what happened? Well, I love technology, and my pursuit was really out of passion. I told my father, I want to be an engineer like you. But I said, I want to be a fifth-grade teacher second. Because he taught me at a very young age, fifth or sixth grade, taught me how important teachers were to learning the skills in life, learning what's going to take you places, and let you have money and an income and own a home and have a family and education. Learning things about the world is something you're born with, a curiosity. You're born trying to open every closet, touch everything you can, find out where things are and how the world works. So, and that part, that inspiration comes out of education, learning things in books that you didn't know before. Later on, I'm going to talk a bit about education because I wound up having quite a bit of involvement there. But I told my dad I wanted to be an engineer and a teacher. The only thing I would never, ever consider in my life, being as shy as I was getting up on a stage. Now, I like to point out to, we were discussing some actor that did a play with something that thinks anti-Apple, and I've never said anything anti-Apple in it or anti-China, you know, labor rules that are different than ours is bad or anything. But so I talked to our CEO at Apple, and I said, hey, you don't have something about me. You don't just license when you're an artist. You have a license to express things in a dramatic way, and what you're expressing is true, but it's portrayed differently. The movie Pirates of Silicon Valley about the founding of the personal computer technology is like every one of the incidents in that movie happened and has the meaning that the movie shows. But they had to guess. They didn't interview a single person for that movie. They were afraid of the screening orders. So they had to create every scene with the personalities of people that didn't act, those people were they wouldn't have said. But the scenes were accurate in the sense of that those things did happen and they were on the right path. And if that had been a movie, it definitely would have won the Oscar. It was much better than Social Network. So well, there are some new movies coming. Steve Jobs, and even one based on my books being worked on, and so I'm very hopeful that these are good, to keep them as honest as possible, and these stories are so exciting, and that's what I'm going to talk about today. I know you'd love to hear those stories too. When I grew up, I was so backwards and social, I just wanted to be like a quiet person that nobody ever sees. Great at my engineering skills. I knew I was so advanced. I knew I could design computers with fewer chips than IBM. But Steve Jobs, when I met him, he wanted to, if you think of life being an ocean of people, we're all in the same ocean. I walk through an airport, and I look at every person smiling. If they weren't here, I wouldn't have this wonderful thing called life. We're all part of it. So they're part of my feeling, the happiness of life. And even if somebody did something really bad to me, they are still part of the game that is so enjoyable to be experienced in life. But Steve Jobs, in that ocean, wanted to be a Mount Everest. He talked about the great people that really moved the world forward. And he even spoke about how you really needed to make money. And you needed to have a company. Because if you make some money, then you can invest it in building something better than you built before. And if you sell that one, you can invest more money to build something even better yet. And that's basically the chain of even helping the world really was important. And getting the world to move forward did involve companies and money. I just wanted to be a lifetime engineer. When we started the company Apple, when we had to do our first fundraising, really. I mean, I was working at Hewlett Packard as an engineer. I was doing a lot of little side projects just for fun all over the place. If I saw a pong game, I'd build my own pong game. I got a reputation in California. People were hiring me to design the first hotel movie system. All these incredible things were happening in the world. I was so central and close to. And I decided I was going to be a lifetime engineer at Hewlett Packard. I would never move up the org chart. I didn't want to get political. I didn't want to fire people. I didn't want to be one of those the awful things you have to do at the top. I just knew I could design some great. I was going to design hardware and write software my entire life. And yes, the early Apple computers. I did all the hardware and all the software. I don't know, and I did every little other task in between and all the technician work and the planning and thinking it out, conceptualizing the products. Our first computers were actually built before Steve Jobs even saw them. So that's how critical, how the sort of person that I was back then. I wanted to be this lifetime engineer working for Hewlett-Packard my entire life. And then came the Apple II, and it was like the greatest engineering accomplishments of my life, and I could type a number into a computer and see color on a TV set. And Steve Jobs came by, and we looked at each other. We knew we weren't going to give this one away. Now, in my philanthropy, we started out of a computer club, a group about this size of kind of geeks, a lot of geeks, nobody rich in the audience, and then there were a lot of academics from Berkeley, from Stanford, and they were talking about the social revolution that was coming with these small computers. In the social revolution, we could communicate better. Somebody could post a modem, a notice over a modem, and then 100 other people could dial in an hour through modems and read that message. This was such an exciting idea. I wanted to devote my life to it. Every 2 weeks, our club met on Wednesday night, and that was the most important time in my life, that meeting. And I just listened. I sat in the back. I never raised my hand one time to speak because I was too shocked. I sat in that row, and I just listened and listened. All these ideas, people that knew how to program a computer were going to take their own little inexpensive machine into work, and they were going to type in the company's financial data and pop out the results of what you should do much faster than the million-dollar computers with the high-paid programming gurus in the company. We little guys were going to be so important compared to the big guy. That was such a stimulating thought to me. Always wanted to be a part of a revolution like that. We were going to have education where kids could be presented problems and type an answer and then get corrected instantly, are you right or wrong, and get taught to where they would use 100% of their brain instead of 10% of their brain. And I will never forget how I bought into all these ideas so deeply. And then my talents were as a technician, as an engineer. So I went home and I decided I am going to build the machine that is a complete usable machine, a useful machine, the first time ever at the right price. And I came up with the Apple I computer. It was really a modification of a terminal I built to talk to the early ARPANET, communicate with computers far away. Superman stuff. Feeling like a Superman is always important to everyone. Whenever you advertise anything, even if you're fundraising, you want to make a person feel like they're going to be either more popular or more productive, or you know, have more money in life. Well, I built this Apple I computer. First time ever. There was a formula, and I went down to my computer club. I demonstrated it. Anyone looking over my shoulder instantly saw the formula right there for an affordable computer that actually could run programs and solve real problems. And every computer before that Apple I had a big ugly front panel that only computer people could understand, with ones and zeros on switches and push buttons to put the ones and zeros into memory. And you had to be an expert to touch a computer. Every computer since the Apple I has had a human keyboard and a TV display. And the only reason I used a TV, I had no money. Having no money, having very few resources, forces you to think well. It forces you to think of affordable solutions. My home television, it was the only thing I had for free. I totally understood all of the signals and timings that went in on a wire into a TV set. I had to unscrew the back of my TV to run that wire in, because TVs didn't have video in those days. And I hooked it up, and I set my signal into a TV, a free output device. What were other people using? Well, they could get a teletype that cost as much as a car, you know, not even a cheap car. A big teletype, metal teletype that could type away to a computer far away and get the results back. And I just cleaned that up so well. A free television cost no money. The keyboard cost $60, which was a lot of today's money, and that was expensive. But I had this Apple I. I passed out all of my designs. No copyright notices. I gave it away to the members of my club because they were on such a grand social mission to change the world. I wanted them to have a chance to build a computer they could always afford. They could get these little $1 chips and plug them into a board and solder all the wires in like I did. Turns out that not many of them would sit there soldering hundreds of wires. They didn't have that skill. I've worked with that skill since I built a ham radio when I was 10 years old. I had to take these kits of parts and had to solder it together. I had a ham radio license. So I had those kind of skills. Well, that's when Steve Jobs came into the picture and he said, well, let's start a company. We'll make a PC board for $20
sell it for $40, and all they have to do is plug their chips into the PC board, solder the bottoms of the chips in, much easier than wires, and they're done. And if we sell 50 of them, we'll get this few hundred bucks each we'd have to invest. And, you know, I didn't know if we'd sell enough to make money. And Steve said, it doesn't matter if we make money. The two of us will have a company for once in our lives. We had sold project after project after project. I could design and build for myself because they were fun. Devices that could make three calls anywhere in the world. Devices that could play Pong and Breakout and talk to computers far away. Every time I built one of these things, Steve Jobs found a way to turn it into money. He came by and saw it and would say, oh my gosh, we can sell this. Here's how we can sell it. Here's where we can go with it. The Apple II was actually the sixth time that happened. Now, I was working on one of the greatest projects ever. It was the iPhone 4 of its day. It was the Hewlett-Packard calculator, the scientific calculator we could hold in your hand, and there were no others in the world. They heard that I was a great engineer, great designer. They called me in for interviews. They hired me on the spot to be an engineer. I didn't have a college degree yet, but I knew how to do the work, do the job. So I had the greatest job in the world, working on the greatest product in the world in my daytime. But I still loved electronics. I had no chance of ever having a girlfriend or a wife. So when I came home, just have a TV dinner, watch Star Trek. I know where I have skills, and I know where I don't have skills. And I really don't have the same sort of skills in fundraising or dancing, let's say. Well, with this Apple II computer, Steve and I knew that we had something very big. And the people at Hewlett-Packard, by the way, turned me down 5 times for personal computers. 5 times. But they would have built the wrong machine. The Hewlett-Packard in those days were building machines that engineers used. They would have built a dull, boring, black and white, little tiny screen, equipped with keyboard and expensive commercial tape drives. I just used a cassette tape to store programs because everyone has a cassette tape and it's free. And when you don't have any money, you have to think that way. Another thing is, that applied to all your fundraising, is the best things I did ever at Apple, all my A-plus jobs, were because I didn't have money and because I had never done it before. But I was skilled at doing something I'd never been around before, never studied, never designed, never saw a design, but building the pieces up, I'll check, building them into a device that would do it, and doing it, and it would always come out better than the ways that were already learned and already known. And you can think it out in terms of this year, 2012, what resources do I have to play with, and what great job can I do, ignoring, pretending like, oh, I know how it's done because I've done it before. Very good to be able to clear your mind out what Socrates says and start fresh from the ground up. So the Apple II was not going to be given away. It was just going to be too valuable. It was going to be the heart of a fanciful life at home with color on a TV with so few parts and so low cost to build. And it was so easy to use right out of the box. And we were going to build the first computer ever with a plastic case. But we were going to sell 1,000 of them right off the bat. We knew that. Because there had been a huge interest, publicity and everything around this new phenomena of personal computers. How do you get the money to build 1,000 when they cost $250 each to build? You need $250,000, you know, and that's probably close to $1 million today or more. Whoa, so we're going to have to go out and find money. First thing we did was approach a couple of people in companies. Steve Jobs was not shocked. He would always go to them, talk to people in companies, and actually, he'd seen my Pong game, and he went down to Atari Corporation in Los Gatos, California, where I live now. Los Gatos, the place where arcade games started with Atari Corporation. Los Gatos has one thing more to its credit, though. It's also the place where the pet rock was founded. Very dull, did it, Los Gatos. But Steve Jobs took my board down to Atari to show them, but somehow he wound up with a job there. I don't know if they thought he was and he was not an engineer or a programmer, but anyway. So now we needed to raise money, And we went down to this company, Conver. We showed them the Apple II in the garage, a demo of it, and we went down to discuss what terms we'd like. And I was an engineer making $25,000 a year. And Steve went to Atari and said, "What do you want? Conver." And he said, "Well, we'd like a few $100,000. I shut up. All of a sudden, I was so out of my league. I would have taken $25,000 instantly, you know, for any design I'd done. And he's talking hundreds of thousands of dollars, and we would have stock, and we'd have control of the program, and this and that. And they turned us down. We went to our good friends at Atari. They loved it, thought it was great. They were about to come out with the first home bond game, which meant millions of dollars to them. So they had to focus on one thing, and they were out. We went to venture capitalists. And we pleaded with them, you know, we said that this is going to be such a huge growing market. They said, "How big is the market?" And I said, "A million computers." They said, "How do you know that?" I said, "Well, it's bigger than ham radio, and there's a million ham radio operators." And it's the correct answer. It's not in business terms. He might have had no business experience. We had no business courses, so we couldn't speak that language. But eventually we ran into that angel, Mike Marco, that I described, and he had saw that the vision of computers in every home was accurate. He bought it. He believed it. He was willing to finance it. Now, he said that I had to make a decision. I had to leave Hewlett-Packard. And I said, wait a minute, I've designed two computers and done a floppiest interface. I wrote a complete basic language myself with no classes in college. I've got all this stuff developed and software demos and everything. I've done that all in a year of moonlight. Why don't I stay at Hewlett-Packard for my lifetime job and do this Apple on the moonlight and on the side? He said, "No, you've got to leave Hewlett-Packard." And he said, "Well, come up and give me your answer on Tuesday." So I went up to his cabana on Tuesday with Steve Jobs, and I said, "No, I've gone inside myself. And I almost just grew up, like I described myself coming in here, a very ethical person. And I'm not going to be influenced by money in the world." And I said, "You know, you're willing to invest big money, but I want to be a little factory engineer for life. I love designing computers. I love writing software that people can use. But the trouble is, I can do that on my own time, at night, and still have my job in Hewlett Packard." So I said, "No." And then Steve Jobs went into a frenzy, and he got all my friends and relatives to call me. One friend, get on the team. He said the right words that matter to me inside. He said, "Look, you can be an engineer, become a manager, and get rich. Or you can be an engineer and stay an engineer and get rich." And that was what I needed to hear, that it's okay to start a company, but you didn't have to run it, you could stay an engineer. One other person said to me, good friend from high school, I called Steve Jobs right away and said, "Okay, I'm leaving." I started telling people to go pack I was leaving, and then I couldn't find my boss. I heard this, people were coming up to me, I hear you're leaving, my boss hasn't heard yet. But so we did manage to start Apple, and we did get our investment money, and Mike Marco was a very honest person. He discussed how he came up with his formulas for how much money was equivalent to how much in stock, and how we would run the company. He was very open, didn't hide things, you know, what kind of people we had to work on hiring right away. He didn't come from a successful, he made his money being successful in business. And he said, marketing is much more important than technology. The products you can create with technology are much less important than being able to convince people to buy it or starting out with the right ideas of what to build to begin with. Sensing the market, what they want, and knowing how to address them with that. So we ran Apple from day one as a marketing-driven company, and I totally bought into that. Hewlett-Packard was an engineering-driven company only because the only products they made back then were for engineers. So we engineers at the bottom of the totem pole could come up with ideas for the next product and didn't have to come from above and from marketing directed down on us. We generally came up with the ideas because we were the users of our own products. Well, Apple was very successful, you know, and when the great wealth came, I had never saw it. The others in the company had really sought. We're going to start a company and make a lot of money. I'd never even thought about it. I'd never expected it. And all of a sudden, you know, I had this wealth. You know, and it was on my own terms. And it was like, I don't know, it didn't matter to me, it didn't influence me. I didn't want to be that person with it, because I hadn't started out with it, which was one of the things that led to a lot of my, you know, really charitable giving, even when I was very young, and Apple was successful. one of the first things we did was when it came about time to go public, you know, I thought, you know what, it's so strange. Those of us at the top have a huge amount of wealth. And those, a whole bunch of people that were just with us when we were only, you know, 8 people in one little building. And some high schoolers I met in the computer club that were around giving me ideas, you know, and admiring what I was working on with these new computers. They're Apple now, but they don't have any stock at all. And something seemed wrong. Because Hewlett-Packard, we treated everyone like a family. And you took care of everybody you worked with. And when there was a recession, everybody took a 10% cut in pay rather than putting 10% of the people on the street with no money, no income. So, and I believed in that family thing. So, I thought, first of all, I took care of, you know, $1 million of stock to each of about 500 people that had just been there since the beginning. That just mattered to me. And nobody could explain why. It was my own stock I was giving away. And then I gave up another huge chunk of my stock. I basically sold it to all the people in the company, you know, in engineering, marketing, and it was called the Woz plan. Everybody who bought a certain amount of stock, when it went public a month later, it turned out that it was worth about a house, was what they got out of it. So that was just because I just didn't really feel like, I didn't want to be only a very few special people get all the money. And that gets back to sort of the sense of the ethics that was in me. Early in, after Apple was very successful, we're not public, it seemed John and I made more money than our parents ever dreamed of in their life, and you know, look at each other. A proposal, there was a meeting in Apple, and I went to it. And there was a group of people discussing this idea to build a museum, Children's Discovery Museum, talking about influencing children and giving them good cultural ideas about the world and how it works, and you know, and caring so much about that child's mind, which had always been an important part of my own thinking as I went through college courses in psychology and all that. And after that, I went to my office, and a couple of the ladies that were starting this thing came over to visit me. And I said, darn, you know, how did this thing ever happen to get developed, and all these plans, and what you're going to build, and where you're going to build it, how did it all happen without me? That was like stuff that was close to my heart. They said, well, actually, it's only planning so far. So that was sort of my first encounter with the normal fundraising. I want to make a difference. I don't want you to be a small contributor. I want to do something I can see and feel. But the most important thing was the people that I had met, educators, you know, key ones that even started key software educational development companies in the early days of the Apple II, were on that board and other things. I believe the people cared so much about doing the right things. And there were only about 5 or 6 Children's Discovery Museums in the country at that time. It was very unknown. And a lot of plans. You know, whenever I built technology, I wanted to see immediate results. I wanted to have something you could type something and get a result, turn a dial and have a result. That interaction, the sensory motor interaction, was very important to me. So, and these people were talking about a museum that was all hands-on. No exhibits that are just behind glass that you just stare at and look. It was actually things that the young children would use. And so I bought in heavily to that one. That one led to things like the tech, supporting the tech and supporting the symphony in town. San Jose was the city I was born in. I felt like the places I came from were such an important part of my life. I want to give back somehow. San Jose didn't have like a modernish downtown area at all. They didn't have museums like San Francisco, who had the great givers of the past financial eras. And this was my city. It's like my schools. I wanted to give back to every one of my schools when they asked for things like, you know, stadiums and football fields and equipment and stuff like that. So I helped establish things. And the ballet, arts groups are so important. They're so struggling. They're always trying to pay. They're always trying to fundraise to pay last year's debts. It just makes me think, I hope there are some ballet companies in the world that actually have endowments and ongoing and, you know, kind of profitable. And I'll talk about that in a very short time. San Jose is an important city because it's part of my life. And today, you know, I pay attention. I'm thankful for Detroit because the recent economic upheavals caused 1 million people to leave Detroit. And now San Jose is the 10th largest city in the country. San Jose is one of 10 counties, San Francisco County, one of 10 counties, this is Silicon Valley. 10 counties in the United States where more than half the people speak non-English at home. That's how much we've attracted them from around the world. So I like to pay attention to all this great San Jose trivia. Something's good, something's bad when it comes to traffic and pollution and stuff. But So I did enough contributions at large scale levels to really cause some great things to happen, and they're all still working 25 years later, which is really great to say about nonprofits. And because it's such a struggle all the way, especially arts groups. The city on its own called and said, "We're going to name the street after you." They put this beautiful street in that runs right by the Children's Art Museum, and they named it Wozniak. I am so proud of that. I'm not a developer, so I didn't really have any say in that. It's just the city was giving back for a lot of things. With the Children's Discovery Museum, we had one leader in our early days, Sally Osborne. She was so charismatic, and she had so much ideas and energy, and she was inspiring and passionate, cared about, you know, what this every aspect of this museum and what it was going to mean, and she really, you know, did more than anyone else, really brought in the necessary contributions from others that, you know, eventually caused the museum to be built. And she was focused, she was hardworking, she was diligent. You don't give up. You believe in what you believe. And you don't just go down one avenue. It was one thing I noticed while I was on that board. Educators are also, you know, they're very good-minded people. They're, in a sense, they are giving. So I went at one point in my life, and I decided, you know what, I told my dad I was going to be a fifth grade teacher. And here we had all these computers and everything, and it was easy for someone like me, with the wealth, to give computers to schools. And I started thinking, well, giving computers to schools isn't that meaningful. It's like you're giving a little of your money, and maybe you don't feel it, and you don't even have to be close to it. And, you know, but I care about young people my whole life. I wanted to be a teacher so badly. And I thought, you know what? You give your own time. You don't just give. That's much more valuable than money if you have money. So I decided I was going to start teaching. Well, first, I took one girl who was sort of dropping out of school around fourth grade. I went over to her house and I set up a computer, four laptops. And I worked with her for hours sometimes writing reports that were funny, and it was really that interaction. And in the end, she came back, she got back into school, she was doing all the work, she was getting good grades, by the time she got to college, she made the dean's list every single semester. So it was in fourth grade, I saw this big success, and I thought, what if I could bring that to other fourth graders, fifth graders, what if I could bring that to more of them and let them find that with this computer tool, a new thing that kids didn't have back then, that they could get a lot more work done and it would be enjoyable, it would attract them to doing the work. So that's when I started teaching, scared, didn't know if I could do it. Wound up teaching for a long time, 8 years. I would teach fifth grade every year, the fifth grade class out of one school, every student. It was a little public school in Santa Cruz Mountain with only one class of fifth graders, so it wasn't, you know, 500 of them. And I walked in and I started teaching sixth through ninth graders, an advanced class. And I started teaching teachers in the district and filling the computers, the schools with computers during the wired network days. You know, the world was changing from personal computers into networking, and the internet came, and then I was supplying internet to the whole school district, and I became a network administrator. My son, Michael, moved to New York to be a high class pimp. Good. That's what he wants to do. You know, but if he wanted to be a network administrator, out of the house. Horrible job, because when things went wrong in the school district, and 600 computers aren't reaching the internet, is it my equipment? Is there something wrong? I'm in the middle, and or is the guy that's supplying me with the internet? And went through an awful lot of learning in those days, just sort of learned more than anything else. I don't want to do everything full time forever, like keeping networks running. On our Children's Government Museum Board, we had some good educators, we had some good accountants that were very important and knew how to keep track of all the numbers and know where we were and what we needed to raise and have all those numbers. We had help from the city. The city gave us a beautiful site, park. I mean, what an incredible donation. And they also gave funds that came from some urban renewal funds because San Jose was undergoing some tremendous urban renewal in those days. And the Children's Discovery Museum had great success to this day. Very colorful, delightful building in San Jose, California. Largest city in Northern California, larger than San Francisco if you're ever there. The tech, of course, represented what Silicon Valley was famous for, and so I was the early seed money. Someone's the early seed money lets the designers go through all their phases, hundreds of thousands of dollars, to create all the plans that can now raise other monies that can actually get things built. So the first money's the hardest. It's very hard to do something the first time. Hard to convince yourself of it. I had a two-story wooden pole in my house at one point, and my young son, Jesse, would climb the pole just a few feet up and come back down, all scared. And then his little sister, well, she was small, so she couldn't do as much. She would try to climb it, not nowhere near as high as Jesse. Jesse was older. Jesse would climb up. Eventually, after a half a year or a year, he got halfway up the pole, and he slid down. But Sarah could go up, but never, you know, only about half as far as Jesse. Finally, one day, might have been a year or two of time, he climbed up all the way up the ceiling and touched the ceiling. He came down, and we were all applauding. And his little sister Sarah, fast as you could imagine, Jesse just up and touches the roof and comes down. Once you know something's possible, you can do it. Once you know that somebody... That applies a lot to technology, because we build something, a device that works a certain way, and everybody in the world, oh my gosh, that's the secret. Now I can do it. It's easy. They don't realize how hard it was for the very first person to try everything in the world, not knowing what works and what doesn't. And once you show people what works, they know. And that would apply to your own jobs as well, or any jobs in the world. The ballet. I like the ballet because it's people who care for the right reasons. It's like they get an emotional experience. One woman and her wealthy husband, they had actually met at a ballet in New York, and that's where they really kind of fell in love. And so they were. When you're driven by emotional reasons, nothing to buy that. You know, your inside reasons are in your head. Your intrinsic reward system, your intrinsic motivations are so much stronger than the rewards that are extrinsic, like a salary, a job title, awards, all these little fanciful things, your name on a plaque. Doesn't really mean as much as knowing inside, you know, that you did a really good thing and being recognized for it. Well, so at the start of the ballet, I actually have been in a lot of ballets. I've had a lot of little cameo roles. The lecture screens and community plays and all the musicals in our high school and lots of I've been on so many stage productions you would never imagine. I don't dance, I don't sing, but I've been in musicals. And I really enjoyed pointing that out to our CEO at Apple when I was explaining understanding of the performing arts, you know, helps you understand certain things that are done. So it's, you know, and it was sort of sad to see how hard it was for the ballet to this day. It's still going 25 years later, but it's just rough trying to find new formulas. We merged with a ballet company in Cleveland. That one sort of went broke. We wound up with it in San Jose and everybody moved there, but we're going through a lot of changes right now. And it's just constantly tough going, and it needs a lot of people going out and making the right connections, and we need some really clear out-of-the-box thinking. Very nice to build a little nest egg of cash, like Apple has. And I don't know, that should never disturb your non-profit status. As long as you're about doing good things, it's not wrong to have a huge bank account in my mind. That's what I think. I was working at Apple, and during these times when I was really giving all the stuff to San Jose, they got me a street named after me, I turned on the Macintosh group and I had a plane crash. And I came out of amnesia 5 weeks later. And I called up Steve Jobs and I said, this is the last chance I can go back to college and get my degree. I went inside my head to come up with that. And I thought, Apple has a lot of great engineers, worked on Macintosh. Earl Smith never went to college a day in his life, and he's as good a hardware designer as I was, and I was known for that. And we had Andy Kurtzfeld write the software and Bill Atkinson on the graphics. And the best people in Apple, the most creative people, have been driven to this little tiny Macintosh project, because the guy who ran it at the time, Jeff Raskin, was the guy who brought make computers easy to use for normal humans. I'm checking my time because I have 27 seconds left. You know, but I knew in my head who I was. You know, what would my child, what did I want to be when I was young and was a good person, and I liked that person. That person would graduate from college. Just to tell my kids I went to a college. Not that I really used a lot of academic stuff in my work, you know. doing your work is more like knowing who you call and what stages to get a project done and what you pass this to that. You don't learn that in school. But in my time off, I did go back to Berkeley under, my name was known, but not my face. So I used a fake name on the Berkeley computer for my last year of college. I used Rocky Raccoon Clark. That's what my diploma says, Rocky Clark. So, you know, you should always have a little bit of fun and fanciful and humor in your work. Find ways to do it. Be with people you like, and you can talk nice things and joke and smile. I had formulas when I was young that happiness was the most important thing in life, and we measured it by not success, how much money you made, how many companies you ran, and all this stuff. It was how much did you actually smile every day, telling jokes with people. And I'd rather be the guy that was on the street homeless, smiling every day and having fun, enjoying it. So I came up with a formula: H equals F minus S. Happiness equals smiles minus trash. That's minus F. But I came up with another one: H equals FQ. Food, fun, and friends. I boiled it down to fun, like concert applies too. Food, fun, and friends. I told that at my high school once, and the kids started laughing. I had to say, well, there might be a fourth F. I put on some big concerts in the California desert, and up came an option. We had made a connection through one of our key people with some people in Russia. The United States had pulled out of the 1980 Olympics. The equipment that NBC took over to broadcast the Olympics was in a warehouse in Russia. This was during the Cold War, not even Perestroika days, Cold War. It was like Al-Qaeda. The equipment was there, and some peace-oriented people in Russia that were technicians wanted to pull the equipment out of the warehouse and see if we could establish a satellite connection. Would it be possible? It was like almost not legal, but there was no law against it. You had to wait 2 weeks to get a phone call to Russia back then. But we got a president of a phone company to arrange a telephone call so we could do the setup on the day. We were going to broadcast some of our music from our stage to Russia, and they were going to broadcast some music of their musicians back to us, a group called Amnesty. And the first time ever, a big screen called the Diamond Vision was ever used at a concert in the United States, and the signal actually appeared. It came. We didn't know if we'd be able to pull it off that day. It was just a trial, and it appeared. We had the first space bridge ever with Russia. I ran across the stage to Bill Graham, didn't go up to announce it. And he said, it's a face beam. It's coming from a Southern California studio. Just to have some weird avenue. Okay, I had to go up to the microphone, I announced it. There was a lot of booing, because it was like, we've got a connection with Al-Qaeda. The next year, we had people talking to people about music, clothing, things that they'd like to do in life, the sort of food they ate. And I just sort of realized they're just like us. And all these ideas, the Cold War ideas, that these two countries are so different, and enemies of each other, and have to destroy each other, just dissolved away. All that propaganda just dissolved away. And I felt something in my heart that I really wanted to devote myself to this, you know, peace effort between the two countries. It was unheard of. Could never get any publicity. The United States. Not one mainstream media would ever show up at a press conference I gave about it. And eventually ABC did a space bridge. They claimed theirs was the first. I actually paid $50,000 fee for the connections, and they were the fourth, but they claimed they were the first. They never mentioned me. But I did the first three for the Soviet Union. I started donating computers into schools in the Soviet Union and making other diplomatic personal diplomacy connections. One year I paid for 240 Soviets, low-level Soviets, to visit the United States for 2 weeks, staying in the homes of Rotary Club members. There was a play with American and Russian kids called Peace Child. And these were in the days we were moving closer to Perestroika. And I sponsored that play to play across the United States. A lot of publicity in the Soviet Union. They were all for these peace efforts. They put me on their national news when I did the space bridges for 3 minutes to every single Soviet. The United States, you never even heard about it being done. When Gorbachev visited San Francisco, I had done so many important things with the Soviet Union. Of course, I got invited to where he was speaking. It was a radio show. And I walked in, and there were all these Apple executives there. Oh my gosh, you know? They had a table. Well, they had sponsored the thing, so they had bought their way in with money. But I was there for the right reasons. I had done good for the reason I was there. So I had to sit with them. I learned a lot when I was teaching for 8 years, teaching kids, and I learned a lot. I I hope, and I still have hopes, that someday computers are going to solve the real problems with education, the real limitations. We haven't really altered much yet by putting computers in the schools. We pretty much are taught the same subjects on Monday, the same pages to the book on Tuesday, the same pages on Wednesday, the same pages on Thursday, test on Friday, same as before, whether or not we have computers. And that's the problem. It's just the presentation is fixed and rigid, same for everyone in K-12 education. And then the testing is your grade is a variable. And why do you shun people early? And, oh, you're not the smartest one in the class, so you're down. And they feel like they want to drop out by third grade, most teachers will tell you. Why is this, you know, and they don't recover in fourth grade, they don't recover in fifth grade. How do computers somehow be a teacher, a low-cost teacher? And then you've got one-on-one. I found when I was teaching, one-on-one, you can never fail. To a small group of people, you can never fail. To a class of 20, I was very good at keeping track of everyone's schedule. To a class of 30, they would sit there and not pay attention because they could always hang out. It was too large a class. California had the 50th in the nation in class size, you know, because of a proposition that we had passed regarding school monies. 50th in the nation in class size, 47th in dollars per student, 43rd in computers per student. We're really way down the scales. And, you know, how can you change that? Well, you could have a vote. You could have a vote to have more tax revenues, a higher tax base on property taxes for schools. And in Cupertino, I paid the expenses of mail postcards for everybody in Cupertino to vote for this election. And we got 64% of the vote. And it failed because the proposition said you needed 67%. And I paid the expense the next year, and it failed 64%. And then I did it in my town, Los Gatos, we passed it, Cupertino passed it. So those two towns sort of had a little extra money. But looking back now, 20-some years later, it's like most of that money went into better buildings, not better classes, not better teaching, not lower classes. We have one problem, which is we just aren't going to ever have the money for schools. Why not? That votes turn into money. A family of five gets no more votes than a family of two. A family of two doesn't want to pay for the schools. So that's where a family of five should have five votes. That's one important thing in the future. Another way, could a computer be a teacher? No. A computer's a good book. It's a good ending book, and you've got to dedicate yourself to it, but it doesn't feel like a human being yet. Once computers have consciousness, might be 40 years from now. Once they act like a real human that knows your heart and soul, you know, I'm going to pull up my iPhone, it knows already when I'm touching it. It knows when I'm talking to it. It hears me, it sees me. Eventually, it's going to hear every little bit of conversation and pop out information, useful facts to help me in my business, even if it's fundraising. And it needs a sense of smell. It's got to tell me how I smell. It's going to know my inside soul better than any human. I'm going to want to be with my friend, you know, and it's going to teach me much more than I'm going to want to be with humans eventually. So that's my theory. Maybe computers will reach that level that they are so human, looking at your face, understanding your expressions, and knowing everything about you, that will really prepare education. Came a chance with basketball. Sports heroes are very giving to charities, very available to fundraising activities. At least where I live, they always were. One of the basketball stars in the Golden State Warriors, Shrinas Marshall, he's supposed to be Lithuania. And I was talking to him, and he was building a school in Lithuania for 400 kids, tuition-free, to take kids off the street, sort of had nothing to put them in this basketball academy, but strict education. You had to attend every class, you had to take every test, you had to do every homework, absolutely strict requirements. You know, and I've seen that done, and it works. It works when you have, you know, a coach that really insists on that, and you'll be able to participate in what you want to. You mix the fun with the work. You do some work, you have some fun. You do some work, you have some fun. I found that to be very successful in my own teaching at home. So I went over to Lithuania and I installed computers in his school. I donated the computers and gave them, you know, whenever I ran computer classes, I always gave the students the computers to keep. They had to feel, it's me, it's my own. Eventually, we ran a friend of mine started a thing based on my computer classes called Dream Camp, where the students would come to this dream camp. It was in my garage in Los Gatos, and these troubled children from New Jersey that had been removed from their homes came to the garage, and we gave them computers, we gave them discs, we gave them cameras, we gave them everything to go for the computer to keep, and hoping they could find something useful in their life to do. And a few of them actually turned out to be video creative stars with the equipment. in later times, but that was actually where I met my wife, so it was a very good thing. My wife and I are nerds. She works for Apple Education. She's around the schools a lot, all over the world, that have the one-on-one programs. And we got married on 8-8-0-8 at 8:08 p.m. That's how we think. We look at a hotel room, we look at the number on the door to decide how good the room is and nothing else. The bed, the settings, the V-bar, doesn't matter. There's a guy I met when I was living in Mexico. I was taking foreign languages, and I went down to Mexico and lived a while, and I met this young guy with Apple II. He was editing music and things and got a picture. He entered it in a contest on a radio station in Mexico City, and the winner would get a trip to England for the Networth concert. And we sat there in the Las Venitas restaurant in Cuernavaca one night listening to the radio. They got up to song number 5, number 4, number 3, and this was so good, we figured it was one of the top 2. His came in number 2. And then number 1 was lousy, so they hand selected. But he had the best one of all. I felt so for this talented, technical guy, stuck in Mexico at a time when he didn't have many places you could really go there with technology. And I brought him over to the Networth to the concert, and he fell in love with London, and he wanted to be the world's best mathematician at Queen's College. So I actually paid for 4 years of his college there. Now, I was doing that a lot in those days. When I ran into individuals, I gave him a mail, handwritten mail in those days. Somebody's father had died, this kid needs a computer, I would just get the computers. If I ran to somebody that didn't know what to do in their life, here's some money so you can go to college. I would always tell them, you don't pay me back in money. The way you pay me back is when you have some money someday and somebody else doesn't, you help them. And that's how you pay me back. It was before that movie Pay It Forward came out. I've just known this. I've done it dozens and dozens of times, over and over and over, because I never wanted to be too shy to be in a situation where somebody would come and say, I'm sorry, I don't have money, I can't pay you, or would feel like not being a friend. And so with Arturo, I told that to him. He came back, to the United States, he was graduated from college, he was so brilliant. Microsoft offered him the equivalent of home and millions of dollars in stock, and he turned it down, because he said something wrong if they're buying you with money, it's too ethical. And he worked for a little company that was trying to build some of the first online games with avatars back in the early days when we had to dial up on modems, and he just wanted to do the pure thing. And then eventually worked for Yahoo and ran along with security. He could type changes in, and it was going to affect instantly on Yahoo. And then Yahoo grew. And it got to where you had to go through so much rigmarole to get the slightest change in that it became an impossible situation. And now he's over at Facebook. He's in charge of a lot of probably all their software at Facebook now. So I'm very glad for him. We have breakfast about once every 3 months. And he always reminds me of how much he's given to young people, help them, giving them mentorship and other things that they needed so that they could actually get somewhere. And he says he always does it to pay back, what I did for him. So that was... Japanese. Now, to me, creativity and humor go together. To make a joke in foreign language means I'm really creative. In Japanese, the words are so different than English words that I went through months of class thinking I'm never going to hear a word that I could trick some English-speaking person with into getting a joke. And then finally, we learned the word in Japanese for umbrella. It's kasa. So the next day, on the way to class, my son was taking it with me. I pulled out my umbrella because it was raining. I said, "Ni casa, su casa." But I ran into this guy who said he worked with the journalism thing and they had old computers. I donated fresh, brand new Macintosh computers. That was one of my schools now, this local community college. And his name was Robert Scoble. Some of you might know that. He's very big in the technical social networking blogging world. He's probably the number one social network blogger. And he's just gone a lot of places ever since then. I recently appeared at a thing called Mega Partnering. They brought out, somebody could put an Apple II board of mine, my original design, in a frame thing with a little sheet of authenticity and some other documentation. I signed it. They auctioned it off for charity, and they got $25,000 for it, which was a month ago. Well, at the same time, same evening, I pulled the watch off my wrist, and then with the camera watch, I think I signed the watch, and I said, I'll auction this watch at a lunch with myself. And that's So, there are always ways to give that are kind of unusual. And a lot of sports stars are available for that sort of thing. I'm not going to talk about Kim.com and his troubles in New Zealand over copyright issues, but but it's very much like libraries and very good things, schools, being able to use some copyrighted information up to a certain number of pages in their class. You know, we've got to make exceptions for the do-gooders in society. In the future, we're going to be talking to our devices like a human being. First time that ever happened to me, I was getting on a plane from the Disney World with my kids. And I wrote a little note on this new thing called the new message pad, the first PDA from Apple Computer, hand-wrote with my own hand, Sarah, dentist, Tuesday, 2 p.m. And I saw a button called Assist, but I didn't know what it did. I clicked Assist. It opened up my calendar. It popped in Tuesday, 2 p.m., Sarah name on my contact list, my daughter's name, and dentist for the note. Oh, my God. All I did, I hand-wrote it without even thinking. I'm trying to go through a procedure to enter it in a calendar. I just made a note, and the thing knew what I was doing. Like it was a human. And now I speak things to it. I say, what are the 5 largest lakes in California? And Siri gives me the answer. What are the prime numbers greater than 87? And I get answers. I don't want wings to sites that may or may not have the answer. I may have to read forever to try to find it, you know? And we're getting closer and closer to all these little questions in life being answered right at our start. That's the technology of the future, understanding human speech better and better, and eventually vision and looking at you, the speaker, and being able to figure out things. I spoke at Abilene Christian University recently. They've given every student an iPhone when they come in. Because they've noticed that the younger people use this technology in their ways. If you've got to spot the way that your people are using technology and incorporate them into your own business. One idea I came up with a long time ago was if you wanted to be very much a giver, which I was, to technology, venture capital was a good way to do it. In venture capital, you invest in risky investments, and maybe 9 out of 10 go south to zero. So you're right off, you know, 100% of your money went to zero, and one-tenth of your money, 10% maybe, shot up to the sky and, you know, made you a little profit, made you a reasonable profit. Venture capital makes money. Well, then that one that went up, if you were to donate it to a nonprofit, you get to write the whole thing off. So you got to write off your losses, and you get to write off the gain. It's like 2-for-1. You can maximize the amount of money that goes into nonprofits if you structure that well. That was an idea I had. I've never heard of anyone actually following it as truth. I'm going to have a quick summary. First of all, fight negativity. Don't, you know, when people tell you you're not on the right course, if you believe in it, it's in your heart, you know, it's okay. You know, keep going and try to raise your funds that way. Innovate, be willing to write the book. Don't necessarily follow the way other people have done it and using their answers. It is hard to do things the first time. First of all do-good organizations should be nonprofit, even if they build up huge profits. I don't know if that's actually how it is accounting-wise these days anyway. You should be efficient. Don't be afraid to use local celebrities like I described. You should have a flat tax someday. The flat tax should include capital gains. Capital gains are always excluded from people's thinking about that. The big companies make the big money on capital gains. The big wealthy people make on capital gains. Well, my God, they were just taxed higher. They have much more incentive for write-offs. Be passionate. Care for what you do. Be efficient. Embrace technology. Use it to help you organize everything. And most important of all, make this a better world. Thanks very much.
We work with a lot of big donors and small donors, and they're all equally important. great wealth, but you have a huge heart. How would you work with people like you? How do we connect with people like
well,
you?
Well, I gave away more wealth than
heart.
Anyone. So
okay,
no, that's
really
the heart
great. That I'm
the heart. You know, it all comes back. Your personality is really pretty solid after age 20. Just like we learn psychology, and I see that everywhere I go. And I know a lot of people that I did incredibly great things for in their life, and gave them equivalent to lots of money, and they would never really pass on. It just wasn't in them. Not everybody is that way. But I care. I notice when I see people that care about the world, that almost all young people, when they're 10 years old, they're almost all just caring and wanting to find ways to do good. It comes from learning in school and whatever. And how do you hold on to those sort of values? Probably the school system could do a lot of good, so could parents. Mm-hmm. But a lot of times parents are pushing you to make the most money and be the dentist.
Yes. You pointed out about how many of grew up wanting to be a fundraiser. I won't name that one person.
It's okay to want to make a lot of money.
Yeah.
Like Steve Jobs, because then you have a chance. You have a lot of choice on how it can be. So you come out of what you
right.
like, your personality, if you're a giver, that's how it'll come
so
out eventually.
In your philanthropic activity, do you work with fundraisers a lot like that? People like that?
Not a lot, just occasionally. Pretty much I'm close to home. I mostly run into people who want money to start company projects.
Okay.
I run into a little more of that, more known than the technical.
Because it sounds like you actually seek out.
Yes, very often I was in control. In other words, yes, fundraisers would be talking to me, but I would want to be a certain, this is an activity I believe in, and I believe in it because of you, the people, are compassionate and care. And so I would never give a gift that had any restrictions. And I've run into other people, ran into one.
We call it.
Never gives a restriction on his gifts.
None at all.
Yeah, because I don't want to be, I want to trust that the good people who know how to do things better than me.
Okay.
And not, you don't have to make me feel like, oh my gosh, I had some input, so therefore I have more incentive to give.
Have you faced any challenges in giving?
No, well, maybe just minor. But like if I gave $10 million to Berkeley, I'd get the building made that for me, but I don't want to give $5 million. So all I got was
to be there next year, so maybe.
Yeah, very important to me. I think Steve Jobs is great. He commenced his speech at Stanford.
Yeah.
And Berkeley's Stanford.
Yeah. I'm sure you pointed out that too when you shared the past.
Oh, no. Well, new program. I mean, I was in, you never went to college, girl. I went to work.
Okay. Before we started, he very graciously allowed me to take someone to take a picture of me with him on my BlackBerry. And I asked permission for seeing it. I haven't made the switch yet. So what's the release date for the iPhone 5? And if it's soon, I might actually.
Oh,
I was hoping
I could get a chance to tell you.
Okay.
But I'd have to kill you. I tell you the truth, I wouldn't know for sure. The people that could hold it up and change it are not myself. And I wouldn't know.
Okay. So staying with technology, because this is a technology conference. Fascinated, if you could tell us, what technological innovations of the past 30 years did you not see coming that has really changed how we do things? Or was there anything?
I'd say broadband, except availability.
Okay.
Personal computers and the computer's growth was, there are ways to predict it. Computers have enough memory to store songs and move it to video. Oh, I was predicting that very early, because those are the sort of things I did when I was young in the analog days. The internet coming. We actually saw a little vague form of that internet that led me to design my terminal that became the Apple I, Apple II. So the internet being worldwide was there, but broadband to everybody was quite a surprise. Even when I jumped into the internet in the early days, I got a 3-letter .com, Woz.com. But because I'm not T1 line the universities have. And I was the king of the hill, and everybody else had dial-up. And now I'm bottom of the hill because I don't get broadband in my house. And I pay 10 times as much for my T1 line, but it's 10 times as slow.
You're probably a little off on that, I'm afraid.
But I'm glad. The broadband for everyone really made a huge amount of change on the internet.
So, Pat, was there anything that came out on the market that you thought was going to be really successful and then?
Well, occasionally a product is just so strikingly artistic in a sense. We talk about Apple being the emergency doctors of technology and art, and art is usually the visual art. We have this one machine designed with no fan called the Cube, with a little cylinder up the middle for the air to carry the heat away. Beautiful. God, it's my home computer for 2 years. I loved that machine, and Apple dropped it. So a few products that were really outstanding in that way. As far as actual technologies that didn't take off, no, sometimes there was a technology that started to take off, but something else would come out and be so much better in a different direction, people would go that way instead. So it's very hard. You can't really make guesses until you can see the future, too.
Well, no one else can do that.
Yeah, you can guess. You can guess the future.
Okay. So you use Twitter and Foursquare?
Actually, I use Foursquare where I check into hotels, airplane flights, things like that when I travel around the world. I check in a lot, and it shares it over Twitter and Facebook, which is a problem. I don't use Twitter and Facebook. I've got to tell you, I'm in a problem. I had these philosophies when I was 20 years old that brought me happiness, but part of it is not being closed off to the world, and so I could never allow myself to have an unlisted phone number, that sort of thing. So I have thousands of friends on Facebook and Twitter, and every time I check in somewhere, I get hundreds of real responses, and I've got to answer them all back and deal with them, and it's like, oh, my life on the internet is way heavier than it should be. So I haven't had time to go and explore how do you use Foursquare and Twitter effectively. I just use them as my little check-ins,
okay.
Yes.
Is there any?
And it's a very good, but it's very good at Twitter, especially if you love being so short when I haven't been able to use it. On brief occasions, I've taken myself into it. Works beautifully, but I just don't have time.
It's been a fair amount of speeding in the last hour, by the way. Is there any thought that there seems to be coming in the social media area that you think is really going to be the next big thing?
I'm not close enough to use it to really want to predict in that area. Obviously, I talked about speaking to your mobile devices is going to become more and more commonplace. I prefer to send emails, and if I'm in any place and I can actually speak, whatever it is, request it, navigate. Want to make a phone call? I just prefer to speak and not think about procedures. So it's the procedures that get in the way, and I think those will start to disappear more and more with the social media. Maybe a lot of people like to tap because nobody can sort of write.
Yeah. So you actually said there were two things that you weren't good at. One was fundraising, and the other one was dancing.
I'm not born.
Then you mentioned that you were actually in ballet. So I never saw you.
A lot of ballets. Okay.
I never saw you on Dancing with the Stars. Was there a ballet?
No. I was in the San Jose Ballet.
You were in San Jose Ballet.
Oh yeah. I've been a lot of musicals. The high school I've offered with kids and with community plays. I'm not an actor. I can't learn lines. I can't remember them. I can't do anything, but I wind up answering the phone saying yes.
So did you enjoy Dancing with the Stars?
Dancing with the Stars, when they called me, I knew they had made a mistake. I didn't watch television. I don't know what it was, and I heard dancing. They screwed up. And then they worked on it for a year, and I met the producers. They were nice people. But I said no. And then they were nice people. And I said, no, again. And then a friend got me to change my mind. And I jumped in the water. If you don't learn how to swim, you're going to drown. And you jump in. And right away, I thought, oh, my God. 6 hours a day, 7 days a week. I can't learn this stuff. I can't remember to connect the whole dance. And I'm aching so hard, I couldn't feel a broken bone from your toes to your hips. You're aching so hard. And I think it's the first decision I ever made. And then finally, I got it down to my knew that I was going to always recover. If I made a mistake, big deal, to smile, but I wasn't good. I was going to be able to continue and finish the dance. And then I started thinking, I'm so lucky to be such a nerd. How can a nerd? Here they are. The lights are dim. They're announcing stuff on TV, and we're about to dance. I'm not thinking about my steps at all. I'm thinking about, I am so lucky to be here. like me ever gotten on this show. And I smiled to the audience, and I had the greatest one.
Were you disappointed when you were, when you...
But talk about being Mr. Nice Guy. I kept trying to raise some money on this, but at first I felt a little angry here in my trailer. I found out what a star trailer was. I learned about how three TV shows are made. And all of a sudden I said, oh my gosh, everybody in the show is going to give little gifts to everybody. I've got to do that. So I went out and I bought a bunch of bags. And I went to store after store after store in LA. You don't have much time left when you're training for Dancing with Stars. So I looked for these little books that had factoids of the world. You know, some little facts you didn't know. That was my favorite time to joke with them. And I put in my little metal business card and some sheets of money that a printer makes in my hometown of Los Gatos. And I put a letter on the computer saying, here's how it's been. Let's give you your info. And then I hand-wrote for each of 27 people, the professionals and the authors, hand-wrote a letter telling each of them why they were good people. So, and then I put that in there, yeah. And then the next season, I told Lonnie Osmond he should do that. He said, yeah, he would, but he didn't. 27, all these letters by hand, walked to write. They were all 1 or 2 pages.
That is.
Yeah.
Because we don't write that
hand anymore. Yeah. But it's personal, so it's nice. Mm-hmm. It's kind of like, you know, giving myself as a teacher means more than giving computers to students.
Yeah. You really, really talk a lot about education. I bet you're a great teacher.
That's what the students would say. You know, it's kind of neat because they come back in later years and they're all successful in life and they thank you for what you gave them. Mm-hmm. So I could do. Every teacher goes through that, I'm sure.
Have you instilled in your children a sense of giving back to the community?
I didn't believe in forcing my values to say, here's the right thing to be. Mm-hmm. So I serve as an example, and I try to pull a lot of my famous luxury and being on stage just out of their lives. They wouldn't see much of it.
Mm-hmm.
So I did a little bit, but then they would hear from others that I was known for that, not in my community, but the schools. Mm-hmm. So yeah, they knew it. Mm-hmm. Yeah, they were some of my own students.